In this video, I'm going to demonstrate the primary technique I use to scrape websites with the Ultimate Web Scraper Toolkit. The first step is to visit the web page that will be scraped using a real desktop web browser. When bulk scraping, I like to select 2 to 3 pages that are representative of the majority of what will be retrieved. In this example, though, there will be just 1 page retrieved. The desired objective for this exercise is to know what the current delivery status is of this particular order. All major web browsers these days have built-in tools for analyzing and manipulating the document object model, also known as DOM directly. DOM is just a fancy acronym for HTML that has been processed and rendered. I'll use the term DOM regularly. What these tools are called varies from browser to browser, and the features are usually buried under a menu item like Developer Tools or some such. There are 2 tabs in Developer Tools I spend 98% of my time in when doing web scraping: the Inspector and Network tabs. I usually start with the Inspector tab to figure out what the DOM looks like around the data I'm interested in retrieving. Clicking the little arrow starts the process to drill down the DOM tree. Selecting the delivered text expands the DOM to the element I just selected. I can then use the arrow keys on my keyboard or hover over sections of the DOM tree to find a unique ID or class that I can key off of later. To start web scraping the content, I'll download a copy of the latest version of the Ultimate Web Scraper Toolkit and extract it. Next, I will copy the URL and go write a quick PHP script to retrieve the URL using the toolkit. Running this script turns up nothing. There's one more step I generally like to do before I fire up my editor to start writing code. I'll right-click, go to View Source, and perform a quick search for the bits of the DOM I'll be looking for in my code. In this case, the string doesn't exist in the document, which explains why the script failed to find anything. Viewing the source HTML first helps save time and frustration by avoiding the task of writing software that does not work. As a software developer, I tend to notice things. Let me reload this page a couple of times and watch carefully for unusual behavior. Notice how the page takes a moment to load the area that I'm interested in retrieving? The delay indicates that there might be a secondary network load taking place. Data isn't magical. It has to come from somewhere, and inline text in the main HTML content will generally render on screen almost immediately, while remote resources over the network take time to retrieve and usually pop in later. Various animations and seeing the footer of a website before the actual information appears are also significant clues that the desired information is coming in over the network and not part of the initial page request. So the next stop is the Network tab. This tab in Developer Tools usually requires a reload to get it to show the list of requests made to a server. It shows a lot of information, and there can be hundreds of requests made to many different servers in this list. However, we can narrow down what we are looking for very easily. Looking at the URL of the retrieved page for something unique, such as an ID, can be used for mentally filtering out unimportant requests from the list. The next step is to find possible network requests in the list that might retrieve information using the ID from the URL. The magic words to watch for here are API, POST, XHR, and JSON. Focusing on these terms usually reveals infrastructure where data is stored. Looking at the request list here, I spot what looks to be an API that is simply passed the ID from the URL and it returns JSON. There's also a WebSocket in use on this page. It's a bit unusual to see, so it might or might not be important. I may need to glance at the request headers in a bit if I hit another wall, such as sending cookies that might need to be part of the request. At this point in the process, though, I'm mostly interested in finding out if I've struck pay dirt. The response tab shows a breakdown of the JSON that was returned from the server. There's a lot of juicy info here, but the events array appears to contain the text I'm looking for. Now that the content has been located, it's time to scrape it. Having a JSON API potentially makes this process a lot easier. I'll copy the new URL and modify my code from earlier. Since this is just another GET request, there's probably not much complexity involved. Dumping the output with var dump at each step is useful to confirm that the code is working properly this time. Here I see that the JSON is retrieved successfully, but stored as a string. A quick JSON decode converts the string to a PHP array and allows me to extract the event subarray with ease. The technique I just demonstrated can be used to access resources that make web scraping easier. The Ultimate Web Scraper Toolkit is very powerful, so only use it responsibly and for the betterment of society. This concludes the primary technique I use to scrape websites with the Ultimate Web Scraper Toolkit. Be sure to like and subscribe, and thank you for watching.